Hey, we're in 2 Timothy, if you have your Bibles. 2 Timothy chapter 3. This is the continuation from last week's message, where we started at the beginning of 2 Timothy chapter 3. And today we're going to work our way through the end of it. We're going to start in verse 10. And what I would like to do is just start in verse 10. Let's read the section that we're going to be looking at this morning. And then we'll move into our message. So 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 10. Looks like you all have it on your Bibles or devices or apps or scripture journals, whatever you're using. It looks like we all have it. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 10. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and suffering that happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and impostors will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Let's pray. Father, would you take this word? Would you use it to encourage us, to show us a bit of your goodness, to show us how to continue in the faith that has been laid out for us? And I ask that you would just speak through me in a way that we will know when we leave here that we have heard from you and met with you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we looked last week at this passage and really saw in verse 14 is the central charge. This is the key to this passage. When he says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned. And it's a call to continue. This was really our thrust of last week's message, and we saw that he really lays out two paths in this section. He says, here's the example that I've laid for you, you've seen me model ministry and godly character and perseverance, and continue in this. And that's in opposition to or in contrast with these false teachers who love the wrong things and live the wrong way. And they were predators creeping into the homes of spiritually vulnerable people and taking them captive and talking and talking and talking, but they keep learning and never coming to the truth. And he says, avoid those people, but instead continue in the way that you've learned, in the ways that I've modeled for you. I made the point last week that was the what. That was kind of the heart issue, where we read this and determine within ourselves, do I really want to continue down the path? I mean, it's a heart issue of saying, yes, Father God, Lord Jesus, this is what I want. I want to be faithful. I want to live for you. I want to be one who doesn't end up in the ditch spiritually, but one who continues in what I have seen and what I have heard, what I have deeply believed, this I want to continue in. And when we get to that point of saying, yes, this is what I want. I want to continue in this. Now that we've kind of committed to the what, then we move to the how. How do we continue on this path? And I don't know about you, but I think we need both the what and the how. For example, if you go to the store and you buy Legos, right? I love Legos. But you see this box, and it may have a picture of, let's say, the Batmobile on the box. And you're thinking, this is cool. I'm buying a Batmobile. Well, you go home and you open the box. There's not a Batmobile in there. Do you know what's in there? A bunch of Lego bricks and a few wheels. And if it's the Batmobile, they're all either black or gray, right? You just have this assortment. And if you were to take this box of Legos and say, okay, this is what you're going to build, that'd be hard if you're only told the what. But the good news is there's one other thing inside that box. There are instructions, there are directions, step by step. You will take these thousands of Legos and take hundreds of steps, but you will end up with a Batmobile because you're told what, you're also told how. It's kind of like shopping at IKEA, right? You walk around upstairs and you see this great trendy furniture. And you're thinking, that would look great in my house. And then you go downstairs to pick it up, and they don't give you a bed or a couch or a chair. They give you a bunch of boxes. And you take this home, and you spread it out all over your room, and you say, okay, somehow this is going to be a bed or a couch or shelves or a kitchen table or something. But right now, it's just a bunch of wood panels and particle board and hardware and Allen wrenches and... But there's one more thing inside that box, isn't there? It doesn't just tell you what to build. It tells you how to build it. By the way, I did see on social media, I guess IKEA just celebrated a birthday, and someone had a picture of an IKEA birthday cake. And it was just like two eggs and a cup of oil and some... That's not allowed for the cake baking contest. You cannot bring an IKEA cake to this. Just, well, you can, but it won't beat my cake. All right, moving on. So here's what's great about Scripture. We are often told what to do, but we're also told how to go about it. And in this passage, he has just laid out, Timothy, here's what you're called to do. You're called to continue in what you have seen in me. And the way we phrased it last week, to continue walking in the right path, even when it's difficult. That's the what. And then he gives the how. And he really gives two resources in this section for how we can live out this desire to continue in the way that we have been taught and the things that we deeply believe. How to stay on the path. How to continue. We're going to see this morning that Paul lays out a way that we're to walk in. And he's also going to point to the word that we are to live by. And it's interesting. I'm setting this up as kind of point one and point two, but I also want you to understand, point one builds on the foundation. The way that we are to walk in builds on the foundation of the authority of Scripture. I mean, this passage builds to this climax, this crescendo of celebrating that Scripture has been breathed out by God for us, and it's profitable, and it equips us. But before we get into that, I want you to notice, because I think Paul makes an important point here. Go back to verse 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed. Now notice this next phrase, knowing from whom you learned it. So when Paul is encouraging Timothy and to us as well to continue in these things that you've learned, that even though times are difficult, keep pursuing. I mean, this is our theme that we're talking about for this whole book. Keep the faith. Don't desert the faith, but keep the faith even when times are difficult. One of the arguments Paul gives for how to do this is, Timothy, consider who you learned this from. Look at my example. You know my heart. You know my ministry. You know my character. When you look at the faith, and in these difficult times, when you're facing opposition from false teachers and all this stuff, Timothy, remember who you learned this from. Remember what you've seen in me. This is what he's saying. And to really catch this, you need to go back up to verse 10. And we quickly touched on this last week, but let's go back to this. Paul talks about when he says, remember who you learned it from. This is who I am. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and suffering. And you can kind of take these three at a time and you notice there are themes. For example, I think the first three relate to Paul's ministry. You have followed my ministry, my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life. Timothy, you've seen my ministry, especially my teaching. And let's just drill down into this a little bit. If you were to summarize Paul's teaching that Timothy had heard over and over and over again, I think you have to say what he heard was the gospel of grace, that there is a righteousness from God apart from the law that is found in Christ Jesus. And that we are born again into the family of God. We are redeemed and purchased and brought into the body of Christ. We're adopted into his family, not by our ability to obey the law or to live up to a certain standard, but only through the grace of God, which was lavished on us through Christ Jesus. And what Jesus did on the cross is enough for us to be forgiven, for us to be adopted into God's family, for us to inherit eternal life. It's all about what Jesus did on the cross. And this message of the gospel of grace is one that challenged people from a Jewish background at those days to rethink who Jesus is. Instead of seeing Jesus as a blasphemer that we nailed to a tree, you need to see him as the Messiah and as the Son of God, and to see that being right with God is not through obedience to the laws and sacrifices and all these things we live by, but instead it's through faith in Jesus Christ. And it challenged people from a Jewish background to let go of a lot of things they had grown up believing and to turn to faith in Jesus. Well, it also challenged people from a Gentile background to turn to God from idols to serve the true and living God. And so there was a turning that was required from those who were not from a Jewish background. That we had to turn from idols or whatever we were worshiping, whatever belief system we were in, and understanding that through Jesus we can find forgiveness. And there is no other way. He said, no one comes to the Father but by me. We have to turn from the idols in our life. I'm taking that quote out of Paul's writings to the Thessalonians to turn to God from idols and serve the true and living God. But what happens is you've got Jewish people coming from their background trusting Jesus, and you've got Gentile people coming from their background and trusting Jesus. And what God is doing is forming a people to give him glory that are all gathered under the name of Jesus. This is the beauty of the church, that we come from all different perspectives and all different backgrounds, and God brings us together as his family, as his people in his place to give him glory and to live in his favor under his blessing. I mean, this is what God is doing. And so Paul is saying, Timothy, you have followed my teaching. This teaching that challenges the thinking of Jew and Gentile alike, and as people respond to the gospel, they come together as the body of Christ. You followed my teaching, and what flows from that is my conduct and my aim in life. I live on mission for this purpose, to take the gospel of grace to all people. Timothy, you followed my ministry. Now, when I think of these passages and these examples of ministry, I mean, I'm grateful to look back 2,000 years at the ministry of Paul. But for me, and I challenge for you as well, it gets a little more personal when I think of the people that I've known. When I think about parents, pastors, teachers, godly people, that I've looked to them and I've seen their passion for sharing the gospel. And I've seen people who have committed themselves in ministry, some again in full-time ministry that I've looked to as mentors and pastors and leaders, but I've seen so many other people that are, you know, not in, you know, full-time paid vocational ministry, but people that, whether, you know, whatever their job is, their calling is to serve the Lord Jesus and such a vibrant ministry. And these times when it's challenging, and if we're ever tempted to, like, I just want to quit and be done with it, what Paul is saying is, think about the examples that have been laid for you. Think about those people who have consistently laid for you a way to walk in, a way of ministry. And continue in what you observe. Not, I think in our context, not just from Paul, but from the people in our lives that have modeled what ministry looks like. We move from there, he goes from his ministry really to his character. You followed my faith and my patience and my love. You've seen, Timothy, that I'm not the kind of guy that just comes in and preaches about the gospel and then doesn't live it out the rest of my life. I mean, you've seen the faith that I live by, the patience that I have in the Lord, and the love that I have for God and for people. It's not just something you get up on stage in the synagogue and teach. It's something you live. It's this godly character that gets developed. This is what the Spirit does within you. Now, first thing I notice about these three things, is these are all dangerous things to pray for. Do you really want the Lord to give you more faith? Because that's not an easy lesson to learn. We learn faith when we're stretched to the point that we think God's not going to come through, and then he does. Do you want to pray for patience? Waiting, 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 and then God's faithful. Do you know how you learn to love? You share life with people that are hard to love. And your capacity to love grows and expands. These are dangerous things to pray for. But these are all things that the Lord brings about in our lives, that the Spirit develops within us as we follow Christ. And here's what Paul is saying. You've seen my ministry. You've seen my commitment to get out and share the gospel, to preach the gospel of grace, to plant churches. Timothy, you've seen all of that, but you've also seen my character. You've seen that for me, this is not just something I get up on a stage and do, but this is my life. This is something that's at the core of my being. And again, I'm grateful for Paul's example, but I also think of people that I've actually known and shared life with, or I've seen the love that they have for people, the faith in difficult times to keep trusting, the patience when my patience would have long ran out, and I look to these people as examples as well. And so, you know, I want to continue in the faith. I want to continue to walk in this way of ministry and of godly character, not just because Paul lived it, but because I see lots of people in my life who have shown me an example of what it means to walk with integrity and character and authenticity and to be real about my faith, and I want to continue in that path. There's a way that has been laid out for us to walk in. Well, then he moves from there to his perseverance, my steadfastness, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me at Antioch, and that's, by the way, Antioch in Pisidia, not Antioch in Syria. It's all part of the first missionary journey. We'll get to that in a second. At Antioch, at Iconium, and Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Here's what Paul's saying. When persecutions came my way, when there were afflictions and sufferings, I didn't forfeit my faith at these times. But I was steadfast. In fact, my faith was forged, not forfeited, by sufferings and persecutions. That I was steadfast in the face of opposition. And he lays out these three cities. And he says, you remember this. And it's interesting because Timothy was from Lystra. It was a small village, and this is where Timothy grew up. This was probably his first introduction to Paul. But Paul starts the journey in Antioch. Again, this is Antioch, Pisidia. So Antioch, Syria is the church where the disciples were first called Christians, and they were the ones that sent Paul and Barnabas out on the first missionary journey. They went down to Cyprus, and then they pointed them, hey, you ought to go up to Galatia. So they go up to Galatia, and that's where they come into Antioch of Pisidia. And it's the classic story of Acts. Now, we just spent a lot of time in Acts, so hopefully this is at least somewhat familiar to you. But Paul walks into the synagogue and he begins to preach the gospel. Jews and Gentiles both believe and they trust Christ. And it's going really well until some Jewish leaders, you've heard this story before, right? Some Jewish leaders get upset and they run Paul and Barnabas out of town. This is what happens every city they went to pretty much. And so as Paul and Barnabas, this is the city where they shake the dust off of their feet and they move on to Iconium. They get to Iconium. Do you know what they do? They go to the synagogue. They start preaching the gospel. Jews and Gentiles believe. Can you guess what happens next? Some Jewish leaders get upset and start threatening them. Now, here's what they did in Iconium that was different. I love this. That because there was opposition, they determined we must stay and keep preaching Christ. So opposition didn't run them out of town. It motivated them to stay and engage even more. But eventually the opposition turned into, okay, we're starting to pick up stones and throw them at you, and they decide, okay, maybe now it's time to leave town. So they have now left Antioch, they have left Iconium, and they make their way to Lystra. Now, Lystra was not a strong Jewish population, so they didn't go to the synagogue. But it's interesting what happened. As they walked into the city, there was a man sitting there who had been lame since he was born. Paul speaks, Jesus works, and the guy stands up and starts walking around. Now, the people in the village saw this. And they thought, this is amazing. You know, we have an old legend about a time when Zeus and Hermes walked into our village. They have come back. And so suddenly the village begins to worship Paul and Barnabas as Zeus and Hermes. And it took Paul and Barnabas a little while to realize what these people are doing. So they finally said, hey, stop, stop. We're just people just like you. We're not gods. And he begins to explain the gospel. Now, since these aren't people from a Jewish background, he doesn't start in the Old Testament scriptures like he normally does. He starts talking about God as being the creator and some of these things. Well, things are going well until those guys from Antioch and Iconium make their way to Lystra. And they stir up the crowd against them. And you talk about a sudden reversal. That these people who were worshiping Paul and Barnabas as gods are now picking up stones and hurling them at Paul. How's that for a roller coaster ride? You're being worshiped as a god, then you're being stoned to death. So that's what happens. They stone him. They drag him outside of the city and leave him for dead. We read that the disciples, these new believers, came around and they circled around Paul, and I can just imagine the scene as they're mourning the death of this beloved teacher and leader, probably sharing stories of his influence in their lives. And as they're telling these great stories at his funeral, they notice his eyes open. Turns out Paul wasn't dead. He was only mostly dead. So Paul gets up off the rock pile and walks back into Lystra. Now imagine you lived in Lystra. You have just seen this guy who's been lame his entire life getting up and walking around town, and now here's this guy that you threw rocks at and killed, and now he's walking around town. This was quite a day in Lystra. And this is when Timothy would have had his first encounter with Paul. There's something about this man where even in the face of persecutions, he's steadfast. It's interesting that it says they left the next day, went to Derbe, saw people turn to Christ. But then they made their way back to all these cities. They went back to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch. And they went and they encouraged the churches. They established elders in each church. But we also read that Paul warned them and encouraged them. That is through many tribulations that we enter the kingdom. Now, it's one thing for us to sit here in this gym in comfortable chairs and hear someone like me get up and say, it is through many afflictions that we will enter the kingdom. But what do you think Paul looked like at that point? I mean, can you imagine the physical toll that it takes on your body to be mostly dead after having stones thrown at you? I mean, did Paul, was he bruised? Was he scabbing over? Was he walking with a limp that he didn't used to have? I mean, you saw this guy come into your city, into your synagogue, proclaim Christ, you believed, you trusted Christ, and now here he is just a few weeks later, and he looks horrible. And he's telling you, we're going to have to suffer to be part of the kingdom of God. That's a strong message. And this is what we're reading here. Here's Paul in prison awaiting his execution from Nero. And what does he say to Timothy and to us? All of you who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. You can take it from me, the guy who's about to, according to tradition, about to be beheaded by Nero. I know what I'm talking about when I say that we're going to encounter persecutions, but I also know what it means to be steadfast in the midst of persecution, trusting that the Lord will rescue us. Now, when he talked about being in Lystra, the Lord rescued him by giving him life. We're going to see at the very end of the book when he talks about the Lord rescuing him, it's not he's going to bust me out of prison, it's he's going to bring me safely home to be in his presence. The Lord will rescue. We will face persecution. Now, in our environment, we will probably not deal with beheadings or stonings, although certainly Our brothers and sisters around the world are even currently dealing with that. But when you get serious about ministry and about living with godly character and living according to Scripture, there will be some level of persecution that each of us will face. It's real. It's more subtle than people throwing rocks at you. But in some ways, it pierces just as deeply the persecutions that we face. And I can just hear, as Paul's writing these words, all those who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. I can almost hear Timothy saying, well, what about the evil people? What about the ones who are opposing us? He says, you know what? They're always going to be there, and they're going to go from bad to worse. They're going to keep deceiving people. But the truth is, they themselves are also being deceived. They're not the enemy. They're the victims of our enemy. They are deceived people who are deceiving others. And in the process, they're the ones persecuting us. But Paul says this, you followed the way that I've laid before you. You have walked in the ministry, preaching the gospel that I preach. You have been growing in the godly character that I modeled for you. You've been steadfast in the face of suffering. I'm over here in prison, but you're facing opposition from false teachers. We're both facing persecution. Timothy, you have done this, but continue. This is the point. How do we continue? How do we stay on this path? How do we continue walk on the right path even when it's difficult? I think it comes back to this. Are we giving of ourselves in ministry? Are we growing in our walk with the Lord? Are we growing in godly character? And are we remaining steadfast in the face of opposition? You know, it's not just the what. Oh, continue in the faith. Well, how do I continue? Well, use your gifts in ministry. I found I'm much less complacent when I'm actively serving people. And I grow in my walk with the Lord as I serve other people, but also as I spend time in His presence and just spend time in the Word and continue to grow. So I see what the Spirit is doing within me, and He's developing within me more faith and more patience and more love and this godly character that He's developing, so that when the difficult times come, I can be steadfast because I see what the Lord is doing in my life and the purpose and the mission that he's giving to me. So Paul says, continue in this way. But again, all of this is based on this second resource. It kind of builds to this crescendo of you continue in this way, first of all, by continuing in the way that I've given you to walk in, but also to live by the Word. And from here, he begins to talk about the Word of God. If you skip down to verse 15, and how from childhood you've been acquainted with the sacred writings which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. I love this. And as a parent, I'll say this for me, and I'll also say this for all of us that are parents here this morning. Isn't this a goal you would love for someone to say about your kids and our kids? That how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings? You know, when Paul opened the book, he talked about how your mother and your grandmother have passed the faith on to you, and now here he is saying, you know, ever since you were a child, you've been taught the Word. I mean, this should be one of our goals as parents, that whether it's making sure our kids are in church on Sunday or that we're sharing the Word around the house, at our dinner table, whatever it looks like for you, but that our kids from early on are acquainted with the sacred writings. Now, in this case, when he says the sacred writings, he's probably talking about the Old Testament scriptures that he would have taught. But isn't it interesting how he goes on to say that these sacred writings, probably the Old Testament, are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus? You know, there's this underlying theme here that when Paul would share the gospel, he would go to the Old Testament scriptures and show how they pointed to Christ, and that Jesus came in fulfillment of the Old Testament scriptures. And these are the things, even the Old Testament, he's saying, makes you wise to salvation through faith in Jesus. The early church kind of lived with this. If you really understood the Old Testament, you would trust Christ because He fulfills it and it all points to Him. But notice a change when you get to verse 16. He moves from the sacred writings to all Scripture. And I think here he's broadening a little bit beyond just the Old Testament. I don't think you read verse 16 and say, well, at least the Old Testament is breathed out by God. No, I think he's saying all Scripture. And by this time in the early church, not only did they use the Old Testament Scriptures, but they were already using letters that Paul had written that were intended to be passed from church to church and to be taught as the Word of God. I mean, if you think about it, Paul has spent this whole time saying, continue to teach or follow in my teaching the gospel of grace. It's not just the Old Testament, it's the Old Testament, plus it's the gospel. It's the writings that are being written. Peter would write and talk about Paul's letters as already being considered Scripture. And so we have, I think, full confidence when we get to verse 16 and it says all Scripture to say this is talking about the 66 books of the Bible that we hold in our hand or on our phone. We have the Word of God, and all of it is from God. Now let's work our way through this. All Scripture, every piece of it, is breathed out by God. It's an awesome phrase, isn't it? It's that God breathed out these Scriptures to us. And now there's a slight but important difference. It doesn't say that God breathed into Scripture, but God breathed out Scripture. What I mean by this, you could look, especially, I memorized so much growing up in the King James Version, and it was all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. Have you heard it phrased that way? That's the way I grew up memorizing this verse. But the word inspiration means to breathe out. But sometimes with inspiration, it almost sounds like you're breathing into, as if, for example, a human author would sit down and write. Well, let's take this book. Paul's sitting in this prison cell writing 2 Timothy, and you could understand this to say that he's writing his words, his thoughts, and then God breathed authority into it. That would be an example of God breathing into what Paul has written, but that's not what this is saying. It's not saying that God took Paul's words and breathed into it. It's saying that God breathed out the very words that Paul was writing. Do you understand the difference there? Are you with me on this? That when we read that all Scripture is breathed out by God, that in some glorious, amazing way, God used the personality of these writers and he took their perspective and their personal journeys and he breathed out the words. Again, we read where Peter would say that they were carried along by the Holy Spirit as they were writing these words. These are, we have full confidence, the very words of God that he breathed out for us. And because these words are breathed out by God, they are true. God cannot lie. God cannot be wrong. We know the words are true. We also, because they're from God, they have authority. We don't judge Scripture. Scripture judges us. And we don't stand as judge over what we should accept or what we shouldn't. But we recognize that all Scripture is breathed out by God. It is true. It is authoritative. And as we keep reading, you can almost say because it is breathed out and is true and authoritative, it's profitable. It's of benefit to us. And he goes through and he gives four areas where this is profitable. And the first two talk about our understanding, our intellect. And the second two talk about our lifestyle. For example, he says it is profitable for teaching. It is through Scripture that we are taught what God is like. We are taught the message of the gospel. We're taught how to respond to the gospel. We're taught how to live as a Christ follower. We are taught through the Word of God. And just to pause for a minute, I love the way God chose to teach us through his Word. Did you know 60% or so of Scripture is narrative? It's stories? That when God wanted to show us what he's like, and what the message of the gospel is, and how we are to live, and that he's glorious, and all of this. He chose to use stories, poetry that engages not just our mind, but our hearts and our souls. He uses history. He uses letters like this. He uses biographies. I mean, you go all the different genres. He uses even like mysterious apocalyptic literature that we read and think, what in the world is that talking about? Until one day we'll say, oh, that's what that was talking about. You know, we look to some of this mysterious writings and say, oh, this is amazing that God chose such creative ways to teach us who who he is. But through all of the different genres and all of the different authors and all the different years over which it was written and the all the different perspectives, it tells one story. That the God of glory created all things, and they were good. They were very good. And there were his people in his place in the garden, submitting to his rule, living under his favor. But then they fell into sin. And when they fell into sin, sin passed to all people, death passed to all people because all have sinned. And it all pointed to the point when God would send his son Jesus to rescue us from our sins for all who would believe. And it points to a future restoration when all things are made new. And that's the story of the Bible. This is what God is teaching us. It's the series of creation and fall and rescue and restoration, all in such a way that gives God glory. And the story begins and it ends with God's people in God's place, submitting to God's rule and enjoying God's favor and God's blessings. That's the story that's given to us in Scripture. And we can trust it. It's been breathed out by God through all these different genres and all these different ways of telling the story. It weaves together perfectly to teach us what God would have us to know. It's also profitable for reproof. This has to do with correcting our wrong thinking, our wrong understanding. Again, you think of Timothy surrounded by these false teachers. Well, what do I do if there's some teaching that doesn't sound just right? Well, take it back to the Scripture. Come back to the Word and see if it aligns up with what God has breathed out for us. We see that Scripture is profitable for our thinking because it teaches and reproves us, but also for our lives. It corrects us. We've all been there, right? You start reading Scripture and it's like, oh, oops, I need to make a change. It corrects us, but it's not just a negative correction because it also trains us in righteousness. So it shows that it confronts us where we need to be confronted, but it also gives us the way in which we need to live. And the end result of this is that the man of God, and you can say person of God there, it's not gender specific, the man of God may be complete and equipped for every good work. We talk about the sufficiency of Scripture, that the Word of God is enough to equip us to do anything that God would call us to do. Now look at these three things it tells us about Scripture. It is from God. It is God-breathed. God breathed out these words. It is from Him. It is profitable, and it equips us. So what does this mean? I think of it this way. Because the Word of God is from Him, because Scripture is breathed out by God, I should spend some time in it. And this is not this guilt-inducing, okay, if you're not spending 3 hours every morning reading the Bible, then you're just a lousy person. That's not what this is saying. Notice this is it's a positive motivation. This is saying, look what God has given to us. He has breathed out His Word that we have access to. Now, I've learned something about this service, about this adult English-speaking service at Venture Church, and here's what I've learned. You really like apple fritters. Am I wrong? I thought I might get an amen on the apple fritters, but that's all right. It's a great thing because it's healthy. It's like, you know, carrot cake, apple fritters, all these wonderful things that are great ways to get your fruit and vegetable intake each day, right? There we go. No one has to get up and say, okay, I'm going to spend at least 20 minutes today eating an apple fritter. And it's going to be hard, but I think I can do it. And I'm going to sit there and I'm going to look at it and think, oh, it's so hard for me just to reach out and grab it. And then, oh, I have to bring it all the way to my mouth. You know, we don't, because we love apple fritters. But isn't that so many times how we think of God's Word? And this actually is healthy. but so many times it's a chore when there's so much positive motivation when you read this passage. This has been breathed out by God for you, and it's profitable, and it equips you. This is why I think gathering on Sunday mornings to hear the Word of God taught should be a priority in your life. You should make sure that you're here, that your kids are here, that you're hearing the Word of God taught. I'll take it another step and say that I believe we should all be sharing the Word in a community within a small group. One of the highlights of my week is sitting down with a sausage and egg biscuit with a bunch of young guys, and we work through Scripture together. I love hearing their perspective on the Word of God. I always leave encouraged, both by the conversation and honestly the biscuit. But there's something about sharing God's Word in community that just brings a depth, and hearing from others and hearing how it intersects with people's lives. It's just beautiful. And let me take one more step. I do think we need to be taking some time each morning, each evening, sometime in the day to just get in the Word. A lot of people like to read through the whole Bible in a year. I did that for a few years. My personal practice is I pick a book each month, and I'm just going to focus on one book of Scripture each month. So at the beginning of the year, I pick out my 12 books, and then I change it about four times as I go through the year. But I have a plan, and I'll just work. I'll spend the entire month on one book of Scripture, and I love that. But it's taken some time to be in the Word of God. Now, some of you, if reading is not your thing, if you can read like the same thing 18 times and still have no idea what it says, fortunately, we live in a day with audio Bibles that are, I mean, you can just open the Venture app. It's got a Bible. It'll even tell you what to read each day. And if you don't like reading, hit the listen button and you can hear the Word of God. The point is not you have to do it this certain way. The point is that you love the Word of God that He has breathed out for us and you want to have it as part of your day. Because it's been given to us. Also, it's profitable. It's breathed out, so we want to read it. It's profitable, so we want to do what it says. I mean, if this is true, this is the authority, if this is the path of wisdom, if this is the way of God's blessing and favor and His design and all of this, it only makes sense that we don't just read God's Word and say, oh, that was a nice thought. Okay, let's get on with our day. No, it needs to affect our lives because it's profitable. And so we want to not just read and study and get smarter about Scripture. We want Scripture to change our lives, to have a transformative effect on who we are and how we think and what we love and what we care for and how we serve. This is how Scripture should affect all of our being. And then Scripture equips us, which means we should take what we've read and studied, what we're putting into practice in our lives, and go share it with other people. Because this points us right into ministry, and God, through His Word, equips us to make a difference in the lives of others as we simply take what we've learned, what we're living, and pass it on to somebody else. That's ministry. So here's what Paul is saying. Continue. Don't desert your faith. Don't end up in a ditch. Continue. How do you do this? It's not just, here's a picture of the Batmobile, so go build it out of these bricks. It's no, let me show you how. You know the way that you've seen me model? You know how you look and you see this way of ministry and godly character and perseverance? Continue in those things. That'll keep you on the path. But let me also give you this. Look at the Word of God. How do you continue in ministry? Well, it's the Word of God that equips you for ministry. It's the Word of God that He's breathed out for you. This is how you know what to teach. This is how you know how to grow in godly character. It's all from the Word. So how do we do this? How do we build this Batmobile? How do we build this IKEA furniture? Even more importantly, how do we continue in the faith? How do we keep the faith even in difficult times? I think we look to this. God's given us a way to walk in, and He's given us the Word to live by. And let's be faithful to those things. Let's pray. Father, thank You for this time we've had to look at a very important passage of Scripture, really because it draws us further and deeper into Your Word. And Father, I do pray that Your Word would not just be something that we like listening to or learning about, that it would be something that we give ourselves to. That because it is breathed out, we want to read it. Because it is profitable, we want our lives to be transformed by it. Because we are equipped by it, we want to serve others. Father, help us on the foundation of Scripture to walk in the way that you've called us to. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.